Hello, everybody. My name is Nikos Efthymiou, and I'm going to talk about challenges in total body PET imaging. So, a lot of people have argued the past years about the long axial field of view PET scanners and why we should really care about that and why it's an important step forward. And most of the arguments kind of like revolved around better image quality, which, yeah, obviously we always want to have better images, reduce patient dose, which is very important because it's not that current doses are kind of like lethal, but with the reduced patient dose, we can introduce PET imaging into children and have a new population of people that can be scanned with PET scanners, and increase patient throughput, which actually is something that I always found that it was the kind of like, maybe from my point of view, the least important. But there is also a figure that was published in 2013. And also, although I couldn't really find for this presentation, the figure that it really struck me back then in 2013, I found one from the same authors, which is on this paper published in the PMB in 2013, and these authors tried to do parametric imaging. So they wanted to have images from different parts of the body and extract more information based on how the biodistribution evolved. And reading a couple of those papers, you understand that all these ideas were great, but they were killed by noise. And that was something that was a big issue and still is in normal, typical PET scanners, is the thing that we don't have enough good quality information. But also, there are also, I'm trying to move also the bar from the zoom bar around, but there are also a lot of arguments about why long axial field of view PET scanning is not that easy and that trivial. And the first one is that there is too much data. There is too much data for everybody to handle, for physicists, people that try to model physics, people that try to model detectors. There are a lot of detectors, and the calculations of the various corrections that also Chris mentioned earlier are very complicated and slow. The inverse problem solution, all the algorithms that we work, we have to question again if they are efficient enough for these large data sets. And there is also a lot of software engineering behind that, of how we can speed up our algorithms and how are we going to store our data. I've been already in UPenn, we have been developing a total body PET scanner, and I've seen the very critical problems with storing all this data, not just in the short term, but also in the long term. Because besides the emission data, which are huge, there is also a lot of logistics about all the supplementary data, like the corrections and normalization factors that need to be stored. But then we have even more data for the radiologists, which are very hard to interpret and complex. And it's easy to present in one of your papers some amazing dynamic data and acquisitions and say that, yeah, this is great. But when you talk to radiologists, you see that what they are looking for is this single score, something that it will give them kind of like a yes or no answer of what kind of treatment to follow. So we might be introducing more complex ways to process data and introduce new images, but that doesn't mean that it's easy for people to interpret the results. And also you need to retrain them, as also Chris mentioned earlier, into these new type of images. And then there are all the software that right now they have been optimized to process data images with, I don't know, maybe 90, maybe, no, but let's say 50 slices. And now we have to change that to 600 slices and so on and so forth. So typically we start with a single PET scanner, which is kind of like a ring around 23 centimeters, give or take, depending on the scanner. And then we can triple that, that was the longest, the shortest long scanner that I could find in literature, and even introduce some gaps to make it look longer. And obviously, most people will ask then the question, when long is long enough? And obviously, the first case is not long enough. That was our starting position. But then when we add three rings, we end up in a very interesting situation where our diameter quite matches the length of the scanner. And if you look in literature, most of the sensitivity benefits are going to be obtained in this configuration. So if you would ask me what is the best kind of like length for your buck, then I would, or your other currency, I would say that here is the place where you get most of the sensitivity for the least amount of extra detectors. But then you might want to move even further and go to around 1.1 to 1.2 meters. And this is where you hit the actual plateau, the sensitivity plateaus. From this point onwards, the sensitivity profiles don't really look like pointy triangular shapes, but they have a plateau on top of that. So that means that if you keep adding detectors and make your scanner even longer, like in the last case, then you really need have to argue why you need to scan a full total body at the same time. Maybe there are some applications for that, but you mainly gain access to the legs. And I could argue that if you have a little bit of bed motion, then maybe C is already good enough for you. But that's always application dependent. And yeah, and size is an issue. So don't kind of like think that when you just add rings, you just get only better images. You also, that comes with a heavy cost. So with the five rings, the size of one cyanogram is about 31 gigabytes. And with the sixth ring, it goes to 45 gigabytes. And that means that for every single data set, you will need at least three of those, something like your scatter estimation, your normalization factors of the time, attenuation correction. And then you have also your emission data, which for just a 5 minute acquisition of a single NEMA phantom can be in several billion of events, which depending on how you store your data, in the case of the data acquired in UPenn, that would be around 60 gigabytes. And just to put that in perspective, in a typical PET scanner, all the data that you might need for one patient will be less than the one cyanogram for the five rings. And yeah, so it's quite a lot. But besides that, we also have to address other things like the normalization factors that I have here is that we don't have right now a very good way to get normalization factors as good as we get for typical PET scanners, because we just can't scan enough to get enough data for all segments. So in the first figure, I show you the normalization factors for segment zero, which are good, but for the segment 300, they are not that good anymore. They are actually quite noisy. Of course, you can argue that you don't have so many events due to attenuation in segment 300, but still it's an extra level of noise that comes inside the image reconstruction. And yeah, so I was preparing this presentation mainly for the course that it will not take place. So at this point, I will stop whining about problems with image reconstruction in total body PET scanners. And I will try to give a little bit more scientific, aspect on how my work in UPenn tried to address one of these issues, which is the estimation of scattered events for PET. So it's already Chris said a few things about scattered events and why we don't want them in our data set. And I can summarize them that they introduce bias in our reconstructed images. And that's something that, yeah, we definitely don't want to have. And the most widely popular right now scatter estimation method is called single scatter simulation. And it has several problems, even in typical PET scanners. It works very well, but also it has some problems, which is it depends on tail fitting on noise data. It doesn't work that well with large patients. And we still need an attenuation map, which yeah, has problems with motion and etc. Then we also have Monte Carlo simulations, which obviously they are quite computationally intensive, still depend on attenuation map, and we need multiple PET positions to fill up the out of the field of view activity. Lately, we also have been proposed some deep learning approaches which need large training data sets. And all of these methods are not really well suited for long axial field of view scanners because of the amount of information that we need for all of this. So our proposal was to use an energy-based estimation and take advantage of the energy information that we get from the photons, but most of the scanners right now don't really store it. We actually throw away this information by default. So the goals of this project was to estimate, to get scatter estimation based on the measured data without really the need for prior training and such, and be robust, and actually very important to be fast, and which is very relevant for the long axial field of view scanners, and overcome the current limitation that single scatter simulation has. So I trust that most of you are quite familiar with the energy spectrum of that we get in typical PET scanning. So we get the photo peak of at 511 keV, and the blue line, or purple, is what we usually detect in bulk. And then we can decompose that into two parts, the scatter part and then the unscattered part. So the unscattered obviously looks like a Gaussian, almost like Gaussian, because we have all the detector effects, and that gives us kind of like a prolonged tail on the top side. And then we have the energy distribution of the events that have been scattered. And the problem really is this overlap that we get between the unscattered and the scattered, because otherwise we could set a threshold and say that, you know, if they don't overlap, then, you know, brilliant, we don't need a scatter estimation. But because they overlap, we don't know, we need some way to estimate how many they are under this curve. So the core of the method is quite simple. We just go to a part that we know that we don't have scattered events, and then we scale a model for the prompts, such as it fits our measured data. And then after subtraction, what we get is the energy distribution of the scattered events. And in this example, we see that this is feasible. This is an numerical example. It's not really actual measurement at this point. And that we can recover a shape for the scatter that really matches those that the actual scatter shape. So in order to validate our approach, we obviously went to do some Monte Carlo simulations, as most people do. And unsurprisingly, we simulated a single ring loop of the PET Explorer scanner, which you can find this information even online if you're not familiar with those. And we tested three different phantoms. So the first one is the typical NEMA phantom. And then we have a very bulky 35 by 30 cylinder with a cold slab running through the center. This is very challenging because it has a lot of attenuation. It also extends a little bit outside the boundaries of the single ring of the scanner. And then we have also a very long one with a very hot insert that resembles a hot bladder, which is another challenging case for a single scatter simulation. And what we can see is that our estimation method, if we compare it with the ground truth from the Monte Carlo data, is that it matches very well our data. And especially when we move into the tails, then the match is nearly perfect. And if we compare it with single scatter simulation, we see that our scatter fractions that we get with time of flight or without time of flight, in their case, are very close to the simulated. And while the single scatter simulation tends to underestimate the amount of scatter. And you can see this table that we use the NEMA Phantom, and you might find that 3% difference might be actually kind of like a very important thing to allow. But after all the corrections are applied, this will not lead to severe artifacts into the images. And obviously, we can see that reconstructed images verify that, both with the energy-based method and with single scatter simulation, with time of flight and without time of flight, the reconstructed images are very close to the ideal one. In the ideal, we have excluded all the scattered events from the simulation. And then some profiles. And if we want to kind of like nitpick a little bit, we can see where single scatter simulation sort of falls over a little bit here and there. So, but it's all right for most part. And this is where things start to digress, to deviate a little bit. And that is, and especially it's in the lung residuals. So this is the percentage of residual radiation that we get into the cold region in the lung is in the center of the Phantom. And we can see that if we exclude it from the data set, all the scattered events, we get a 6.1% activity inside this cold region, which can come from various sources like non-perfect randoms correction and et cetera. And the single scatter simulation increases that to 10%. While with the energy based, we get something much closer to the 6% that the ideal reconstructed images have. In terms of contrast recovery, we can see that the contrast recovery with the energy based is much closer to the ideal one. And we get a reduced contrast recovery with single scatter simulation. But here, it's kind of like also my argument that when people present contrast recovery, they should always present the lung residuals, because when you're trying to interpret the contrast recovery without knowing that there is a 10% here, then you might think that it leads to reduced contrast recovery. But the thing is that you have this 10% residual here. And now we move to the very large Phantom with the cold slab in the center. And here is where single scatter simulation really struggles. It struggles because there is not enough room for tail fitting. We have out of the field of view activity, and it's a Phantom with a lot of attenuation. And we can see that in the center, we don't get a good correction. The profile verifies that. While with the energy based, we don't get these artifacts, and also the profiles is quite clear. Here we see profiles that are vertical and they cross through the center. And the reason for these peaks going closer to the edges is because convergence of the algorithm is not that fast. When you move close to the edge of the field of view, we get much better convergence closer to the center. Now, looking at the very long Phantom with the bladder insert, we can, in the case of the single scatter simulation, we can see all the effect of the out of the field of view activity that contributes in these parts inside the image. But this is not an issue with the energy based, because we don't model the scatter activity based on some approximation, some model of our attenuation and of our activity. And when we move the bladder three centimeters outside of the field of view, we can see even in a more vivid way the increased activity that we get near the edge of the field of view, which is not apparent here. There is this small peak in the energy based, but yeah, this is just on the level of noise. And then we moved to measured data. So this is the same 35 by 30 centimeter cylinder that we used in the previous, in the simulated case, but we didn't have a cold slab that matched this diameter. And you can see that the internal of the cylinder is much more uniform than with the single scatter simulation. Oh, sorry. And this is also shown with the profile. And this single scatter simulation is the one that we actually routinely use during scans. And we know that it works very well with smaller subjects. And in this case, we had the cold slab, but this phantom is quite smaller. It was only 20 centimeters. And we can see that both scatter estimation methods worked very well without any issues. So I initially, in the beginning of the presentation, I talked a great deal about efficiency and optimization for this challenging case, because we have a lot of detectors and a very large field of view. And with the new estimation algorithm, we can get our full time of flight based scatter estimate in just half a minute, give or take. While in the exact same case, a typical 2D non-time of flight single scatter simulation requires for four iterations, approximately 12 minutes, which is quite a radical improvement. Of course, what we don't really say in this slide is that, okay, you got your scatter estimate, but you still need to upsample it into the original scanner size. And yeah, then things are not that fast anymore. And there is also in the paper one kind of like supplementary paragraph at the end of the paper that we make, that we mention this direct PET reconstruction, which is slightly different from what we have been talking so far. So in traditional PET image reconstruction, what we have is our data set that we try to correct using scatter and random corrections and so on and so forth. But in this case, we use the energy-based method instead of estimating our scatter contribution, but directly estimating the unscattered part of the equation. And obviously, this is a completely different problem. And people talking about Poisson statistics and stuff like that, probably right now they are quite upset. But there are some applications that it has merit. And I've seen a lot of cases in literature when people want to have something like real-time imaging. They try to take something like a sample from a tumor or something like that. And they need to, at the same time, they would like to have the FTG image of that part of that tumor to be able to see which part of this tumor is the most active. Right now, the only approach that is possible is a very ugly approach with some deformable non-rigid deformable transformations. And this could offer some improvements there. Because if you compare the uncorrected images, which are the ones with the blue, you get much worse performance rather than having this direct estimate of the scatter contribution. And yeah, obviously it's worse than the ideal, and it's also worse than the one that we get through corrections. But it's real time, and this can have value in some cases. So yeah, that's all for me today. So if you have any questions.
Questions for me for Nicholas. Harry? Yeah.
Yeah, I can hear you.
I mean, if you come here, it's, I guess.
Hi, Nicholas. It's very nice work, and thank you for presenting it. It's actually a question about the situations where you have isotopes with extra energy. Have you tested this method? Because if you have like extra gammas, maybe this method would be even better than any existing method. Have anything to say about it?
So we tested it, but not properly. So I can tell you off the record that it works and it gives better results, but I cannot really elaborate more onto that.
Thank you. Anyone else have a question? Oh, okay. Thank you.